YouTube. That's it. That's the whole review. Bye, guys. No, I'm just kidding. So this is my 18-year-older for Good Morning Vietnam. Let's just go ahead and get everything out of the way. This is March's review. I know I said that it was going to be February's, but I got behind and I'm on spring break now, so I thought, you know, why not just keep going the way it's going. So this is going to be March's review, and the next month will be April and vice versa, so we'll just miss January. But that's okay. I'm really excited to talk about this movie. It did a lot of things I wasn't expecting, and so let's dive right into the overview portion. Good Morning Vietnam is a 1987 comedy movie starring Robin Williams and Forrest Whitaker, which was interesting to me because I'd never seen Forrest Whitaker in a comedic role before, but he did really well. The movie was written by Mitch Markowitz, who I don't think has done a whole lot else. I didn't see anything on his IMDb. And the movie was directed by Barry Levinson, who also did Rain Man. That's the most notable film I saw on his IMDb. And that one is on my list of movies that I haven't seen that I need to watch, so I could review that on 18 or older at some point in the future. We could have a double Barry Levinson special, which would be a thing. I don't know. It's not really a cause worthy of celebrating. Without much further ado, let's dive right in. This is your spoiler warning. If you haven't seen the movie and you really want to, stop it, because I'm going to talk about this movie. I'm going to go into spoilers. So go watch the movie, come back, finish watching the review, comment below, let me know what you thought about the movie, if you agree with me, if you don't agree with me. But if you don't care, or if you've already seen the movie, let's dive right into the plot. In the film, Robin Williams plays Adrian Cronauer, who is an Air Force soldier who, well, he's not really a soldier because all he does is host radio shows for the soldiers. His goal is to keep morale up amongst the soldiers. And he is transferred from Greece to Vietnam during the beginning of the Vietnam War in order to hopefully help the troops feel better about the situation that they're in. Things quickly start to unravel whenever Robin Williams' character, Cronauer, whenever Cronauer gets to Vietnam, because he doesn't do things the way the military brass, the top brass, likes him to do it. He's zany and wild and loud, and he plays rock music, and the top brass is very quiet, and they talk like they're on NPR, and they listen to classical music and stuff, and that, so it's the yin and yang that makes the conflict of the movie. Additionally, with their kind of conflict of styles, Adrian Cronauer really wants to report news as it happens. He wants to give the soldiers, you know, a real look at what's happening in the war. I mean, because they're the ones fighting it, but he's censored by the military because they deem it unsafe or whatever. During his sort of spats with the top brass of the military, Adrian Cronauer also becomes interested in a Vietnamese girl named Trinh. And Trinh, he kind of just sees when he and Forrest Whitaker's character, Edward Garlick, and him are driving along the road, and he sees her and he's just immediately infatuated, and so he tries to get her attention and she doesn't want any of it, and so he actually follows her to an English class where he bribes the teacher and he begins to teach the class in order to grow closer to her. In his efforts, he catches the attentions of her brother Tuan. And Tuan is very much the big brother, even if he's not an actual big brother. He, you know, steps in William's way, and he's like, if you want her, you're gonna have to go through me. And so a sort of budding friendship begins between Tuan and Cronauer, because, you know, they start spending all this time together. And Cronauer actually defends Tuan from some American soldiers who are haggling him. And, you know, they become friends, and things start to look up. And because of this friendship, Cronauer is actually saved by Tuan, if, like, you know, unintentionally. We'll get in, obviously, that comes up later in the plot. But Cronauer and Tuan are leaving a bar, and the bar blows up. And Cronauer, you know, being a radio host, wants to He wants to share the news that the war has spread to even, you know, cities and stuff where soldiers are supposed to be safe. And the military is heavily censoring him. And so he kind of, in a roundabout way, still reports it. He does the, this is, don't listen to what I'm not talking about kind of situation. And the military top brass doesn't like that, and they suspend him. And so he is no longer, well, temporarily no longer the radio host. And this gives him more time to spend with Trin and Tuan. He figures out that he and Trin really aren't that compatible. And so that's kind of sad because, you know, they just become friends rather than, you know, in a relationship. This also gives the audience an idea of how important Williams is to the soldiers, because they're all writing fan mail because one of the top brass attempts to replace him, and he plays Polka and is just not a likable character at all. And so the military reinstates Kronauer, but he doesn't want to go back. And it takes the convincing of Forrest Whitaker's character, Edward Garlick, to bring him back to the radio show. Basically what happens is, in one of the better scenes of the movie, the two are stopped in traffic, and there's a whole bunch of soldiers around, and Kronauer basically does a live performance for them, and he learns all their names, and he can see, like, face-to-face the effect that he's had on these people. And that brings him back into the fold of the radio show. Things start going good for a while after this. I mean, Kronauer really feels like he's making an impact, and he wants to make more of an impact, so what he does is he offers to go and interview some soldiers face-to-face and then record that and play it over the air. And one of the other military official, he kind of has two rivals. The other military official is like, yeah, that's a great idea, take this road. And he sends them through occupied territory, Viet Cong occupied territory, and Garlick and Kronauer's car explodes and they're stranded in the wilderness, and just in the nick of time they are saved by none other than Tuan. And so they go back, and obviously if you're two American soldiers getting saved by a Vietnamese person, they're gonna look into the Vietnamese person, and they find out that Tuan is actually a member of the Viet Cong. Dun dun dun! Crazy, right? Just kidding. If you're like me, you saw it coming as soon as Kronauer left the bar, but that's fine. So Kronauer figures out that Tuan is actually, like, one of the most dangerous members of the Viet Cong. Because of his relationship with Tuan, the military discharges him, and so he's being sent home. And Kronauer just has, like, a few days to figure everything out. So in one of his last days, he and Tuan go, and they have... He tracks him down, and they have this heart-to-heart, and Tuan talks about who the real enemy is, and he basically says that, you know, American soldiers think that they're the heroes, but they're invading a country that, you know, they have no business being in, and they're killing people that they have no business killing, and the war is affecting everybody, not just the bad guys. And Tuan basically says that Americans are the real enemy. And this causes Kronauer to have all sorts of self-realization moment that maybe he hasn't been doing the best thing in the world after all. And I thought that was a really powerful moment. It's not at all what I was expecting. You know, 80s comedy to go into. And also in his last days, you know, Kronauer says goodbye to Trin, and he plays a game of baseball with his English class. They've been talking about playing baseball the whole movie, and so they basically just, like, hit fruit and stuff. But it's a really cute scene, and then he leaves the American soldiers with one final message. So some pros for this movie. The comedy. I really liked the comedy, even some of the, you know, more dated references. I didn't get everything, obviously, because I wasn't around in the 60s when the movie takes place, but I, you know, most of the comedy felt really accessible. The portrayal of the Vietnam War, obviously, as I just mentioned, it was a very gray area. It wasn't, you know, morally black or white. There was lots of different factors that went into everything. So I thought that was a really unique way of doing it, especially for a comedy. Just saying, hey, maybe this wasn't the best idea. I thought that was really, really cool. The characters, what few of them there were, I thought were really well developed, if not always so interesting. We'll get into that in the cons. I also thought this movie, you know, kind of played off of some of the expectations. It, you know, it would set up what something was going to be, and then sometimes it would kind of divert, and I thought that was interesting, but for the most part, it was a pretty standard movie, which we'll also get into in the con section. As I said, there weren't a whole lot of memorable characters, which I felt like kept me from being completely invested in the movie, because there were a lot of characters on the military base that I just didn't find likable. Robin Williams and Forest Whitaker really made up for everybody else's performances, though. Also, the movie didn't really establish this, but apparently it was a true story. It's based on an actual Adrian Cronauer and his experiences, though it's only about 50% correct. They made Cronauer seem a lot more anti-war than he actually was. But none of this is ever related in the movie, so maybe that was their intention, but I thought that was kind of weird. And finally, the biggest con is that there's some weird sort of positions this movie takes, because it's very progressive in the way that it talks about the Vietnam War, but it's very regressive in its treatment of its only homosexual character, which, you know, I think if you're going to make comedy, then nothing should be off limits. But there was a gay character in the movie who it felt like he only existed to be the butt of every joke, which is really unfortunate because the movie had a lot going for it, but just having a character to make fun of because he's gay, and it's weird because he's gay, I don't know. I just didn't felt like it fit. Like, that character could have not been in the movie, and it really wouldn't have changed anything. I don't know. I thought that was weird. And so now it's time for my favorite part. I'm kind of cheating with this movie. I actually have two favorite parts. The first one is the scene where Robin Williams is teaching his English class, but he's not teaching them, like, nouns and verbs and stuff. He's teaching them curse words. And I just think it's a really funny situation because in all reality, especially in a war zone, that's probably more likely going to be the English that they actually hear. And also, it's just funny because that's not something that you would actually see in a real English as a second language class. And so I also feel like that's kind of how I'd be as an English teacher, but that's just me. My second favorite part is a more serious one. It's when right after, I believe it's right after Cronauer has his heart-to-heart with all the soldiers, he goes back to the radio station. He plays What a Wonderful World on the radio, and it starts with this montage of all these establishing shots of Vietnam, and it's all this beautiful scenery, and then quickly it turns to, you know, a napalm airstrike and people being executed and all of that stuff. And so all while this beautiful song is playing in the background, and I thought that did a really good job of, one, shifting the movie into a more dramatic zone, and two, establishing that while there are good things happening, the bad things are happening too in the same, under the same sun. So those were my favorite parts of the movie. Do I recommend the movie? Yes. Obviously, I think there's more good than bad, and it's a fun, you know, unexpected movie. I was kind of reviewing this because I was curious to see what it was, and I don't watch a ton of comedies, at least not by myself. I normally see those with friends. And so, you know, I thought people had recommended it to me, so now I'm recommending it to you. So, that's it. That's the video for March. I hope you guys liked it. I enjoyed Good Morning Vietnam. There's a quick update for you in regards to my other film projects. I'm almost finished writing scripts, so hopefully I'll start filming in April and May and through the summer, and I can get more sketches and some new, different kinds of videos out. I'm really excited about the future for the channel. I think that the only way I can go from here is up. Obviously, I'm getting better audio right now. So, I sense dialogue in the future, which is exciting. So, don't expect it all at once because I'm in a musical for my school right now. So that's gonna slow some of my, that's gonna cramp my schedule a little bit, and then I'll be graduating. So it's basically 100 miles an hour from here to the middle of May, but I'm excited. I'm gonna try and get as much done as I possibly can. Yeah, so stay tuned. I'll be back next month with another review. We're reviewing... Rebel Without a Cause. This is a movie that I know of only because of James Dean. It was mentioned in both of the films, both the film La La Land and The Disaster Artist, and it's obviously widely regarded as a great movie. It's a very old movie, and I'm excited to review it. So I think that's it. Remember to like, comment, share, subscribe, whatnot. Like this video if you liked it, dislike it if you didn't. I need every kind of feedback possible. Tell your friends, family, barbers, dentists about my channel. You know, I could really use all the support I can get. That's it for me, guys. Have a great day.